tell everybody your name, where you're from.
My name is Mike Avila. I'm from Texas, Austin, Texas.
You know, outside of Texas, people look at this and they think it's just, you know, a state that's all red and people are you know, the word that they use in places like New York and Cali is that it's backwards and that it's never going to change. But you step in here, it seems like there's a lot of young people that are becoming politicized and have been politicized. What's your take on the state of Texas right now? In what direction do you think it needs to go?
Well, yeah, the outside perspective on Texas, from my encounters, you know, going around different coastal areas and so forth here in the States, that everyone thinks, you know, we ride a cow, or, you know, or we get on a horse, and that's how we mosey around town and stuff, and that's just not the way it is. Now, there might be some areas in Texas where that's still occurring, but Texas has always been a politicized area. Texas is responsible for a whole lot of stuff. The outgrowth of movements of black bodies from the South, a lot of that occurred in Texas, outward moving to the East Coast and the West Coast during slavery times, because those were more more normalized areas and a little bit safer, although they weren't. So Texas, you know, Texas has a long history for those things. Texas also is a state that you know, borders Mexico and has a long history with Mexico and the relations between the governments of the United States and Mexico, and complications, and then, you know, more friendly relations as of today. And specifically here in Texas, you know, San Antonio and a little bit of Austin history is responsible for holding and housing some of the folks who called for revolutionary movements in Mexico for liberty and justice away from dictatorship about 1910 times. And so radical activism and radical politics are not unknown to this area, especially in San Antonio. San Antonio has lots of large groups of people of color, predominantly Chicanos and Mexican-American communities, that have been organizing for years and years and years.
A lot of brown berets are from there.
You know, San Antonio and Austin would be, you know, if we want to speak in terms of U.S. politics, these would be more Democratic areas in terms of the parties, you know, the Democratic Party. Austin, though, would be, you know, a larger split, because Austin is home, you know, or is considered at least home to the last president before Barack Obama. And so, you know, here in Austin and in Central Texas, a lot of people would consider this area, you know, to be Republicans and so forth. And of course, we have had a long history of Republican ties to state politics, city politics, and then smaller local politics.
Well, they say Texas politics, as defined by Bush and right, his cabal of people, have impacted the entire country.
Absolutely.
I mean, yeah, the policies that they bought for?
Well, it's good old boy policies. It's good old boy mentality here in Texas, and that's reflected in the school systems. It's reflected in those of us that were born during the 70s and the early part of the 80s, and before that, of course, the 60s and beyond and earlier. You know, those of us that were born that came from, say, Mexican-American families, were at home, Spanish was a spoken language, but outside of it, we weren't allowed to speak that. And that's not unfamiliar to my generation, you know, and the generation previous to my generation were people that literally dealt with, you know, in-your-face racism in schools, segregation in schools, and those things still occur to this day. In Austin, Texas, we have I-35, which is a very politicized highway. I-35 is the highway that brings all of your products from South America all the way up through North America all the way into Canada, and so it's a very politicized highway. And that highway, by some definition, by some folks, we would say was a highway that was built in order to specifically segregate cities like Austin, because we are standing on Congress Avenue, which used to be one of the central locations for the original city of Austin. Close to Lamar. Lamar used to be the old center of city. Congress Avenue is retaken over. But this used to be where brown and black bodies used to walk around a long time ago now.
Here?
Right. Now you might...
On this avenue here?
You might not see that anymore now, because this area has been taken over by bars and you know, certain corporate businesses and so forth. And all of those bodies have been pushed and have been forced to migrate over to the east side of the highway, over into the northeast, northwest communities. And so if you take about a 15-minute trip up IH-35 from downtown where we're at now, you'll run into Buttermilk Creek area, which used to be an old plantation-style area. The first house that was ever built in Austin is directly across the highway from us over here, and it was an old French plantation. And I don't mean French plantation as in, you know, they were making wines and grapes and smashing those things. We're talking about people that housed black bodies, brown bodies, and, you know, use servitude labor in order to build what we have here and things that most of us don't have access to now. You know, I can't live downtown. I can't afford to live downtown.
You know, you talked about resistance as we close out. And, you know, people like yourselves are very politicized. And, you know, and you don't even go for the okey-doke in terms of just because they're Democrat or Republican, you're not pulling levers for them. Talk about the type of resistance that we do find and the type of, you know, radical politics that are being, you know, explored and embraced by a lot of people in your generation.
Right. Well, it, you know, for my generation and the generations, coming after us, and specifically speaking about Austin, where we're standing right now, Austin is a commuter city because we have the University of Texas, which is one of the largest campuses in the nation. Houses well over 50,000 students every year. So we have a large commuter population of students that come through, and then we don't see them again, or they don't put anything back into the city, don't put anything back, you know, back into the communities that they want to reside in. And so we get a lot of do-gooder students who come through, are wanting to do good things, make changes in the world. Their politics may be framed around where it is that they come from, but politicizing and radical organizing in Texas is very different than, say, organizing on the West Coast or the East Coast or in other, you know, southern locations here in the lower area of the United States, because down here, race relations, especially here in Austin, say race relations between the police and say black bodies, and, you know, black folks that have lived here for many, many years, is it's a very touchy and sticky situation. Austin Police Department has a very, very horrible history of their interactions and dealings and murders, as some people would see them, of citizens of the city because of things that are going on. And a lot of that sometimes is sparked and provoked by radical organizing or progressive organizing. And we have lots of organizing going on in Austin, except we lack a lot of community because it's a commuter city. So we just have so many people in and out, as opposed to, say, San Antonio has a lot of brown bodies who have been there for generations upon generations. And so they have a little bit more stability in communal style organizing and sticking together and having a good bond together.
Do people, you know, they talk about the brown vote being a very influential one as we go into these new elections. Is it in our brown folks that you see organizing? Are they using their political clout correctly?
Well, I mean, it depends on what your stance is on politics, and if you believe in participating in a system, say the, you know, the United States federal system here. A lot of brown bodies in San Antonio, although we might like to think that, you know, brown folks are down with the Democratic Party because it's the more liberal party, lots of brown folks in San Antonio, for instance, are very traditional peoples, raised in traditional homes, and a lot of times those mentalities happen to be something that fits more in line with the Republican Party. And so it becomes a contradiction a lot of times for, say, my generation spawning out of families like that, where we have to butt heads on what we believe are differences in rights and freedoms and where those things come from and how we define them and articulate them amongst each other.